On to How to Catch a Russian Spy. When I talk to people about How to Catch a Russian Spy, I feel like I'm recommending a really great thriller movie to a friend, because this has it all. A regular guy who gets caught up in something much bigger than himself, check. Grizzled FBI agents, check. And of course, terrifying vodka-swilling Russian agents. And I then have to stop and remind myself that everything that takes place in this book is absolutely real. And it actually turns out I owe some spy thriller writers an apology when I thought their work was unrealistic. So it really is that extraordinary. Naveed Jamali and his co-writer, Ellis Hennekin, have really done a fantastic job of putting the reader into the very center of this true story. And you get an incredible inside look at what life is like as an informant, or as a double informant, and it really shows that the courage and ingenuity Naveed displayed when called upon to do so by his country. The book has already had a rapturous and enthusiastic reception in the national media. I particularly enjoyed the contrast between the NPR headline for this book, From Civilian to Spy, and contrasting that with the New York Post's unique take with, This Average Joe Brought Down a Russian Spy at Hooters. So I think this book really has something for everybody. So Naveed currently serves in the US Navy as a reserve intelligence officer, and given his extraordinary and successful run as a double agent, we're very lucky to have him on our side. Ladies and gentlemen, Naveed Jamali.
Thank you, John. That was quite an introduction. So I'm sure you all have a lot of questions, and I hope to be able to tell you what a double agent is and sort of what I did. But let me start off with a very simple story. It actually has nothing to do with being a double agent, but rather when we started pitching this book, and I have no experience writing a book. I went to college. That's probably my claim to fame for writing. And so we wrote a book, and the process when you write a book is not actually writing the book, but rather putting together a proposal. And so we wrote a proposal, Ellis and I, and then we were going around to publishing house, essentially shopping this. And for me, it was this weird experience where I would go into these like boardrooms and do a little song and dance. No one would say anything. They looked very serious. And then when I was done talking, Ellis would very gleefully turn to me and say, pointing at me while looking at the people surrounding us, "See, he's not crazy." I said, "That's odd." And so the first time I kind of just put it aside. And the second time, same thing. I did my little pitch and he said, "See, he's not crazy." And then the third time he did it, I had to pull Ellis aside and I said, "Ellis, is this the barrier of entry to write a book? Is it that authors, if they're accepted, are not crazy?" And he said, "Naveed, yes, it is. It is. You have to not be crazy." So in a weird way, that was very similar to how it was to be a double agent. This was not... There was no email, there was no cell phones. It was very much me sitting with Oleg, who was my Russian spy handler, and two FBI agents who were my sort of, as we called it, the circle of trust. And it became this very intimate sort of feeling where there was no way for many of them to qualify or quantify what I was saying or what I was doing. And what it ended up becoming was whether they thought I was crazy or not. And I guess I'm happy to say that for some reason, both the Russians and the FBI thought I was not crazy. So that's how, in a large part, how I actually was able to, you know, do this operation, I guess, just not being crazy. So let me start a little bit by telling you how I ended up in this whole crazy mess. And it actually started not with me, but with my parents. As the name Naveed Jamali implies, I cannot trace my lineage to the Mayflower. My father is Pakistani and my mother is French. They came here not like many immigrants, not to drive a cab or push a food cart, but instead my father was a Fulbright scholar and went to NYU and was doing a PhD on medical ethics of all things. And my mother was doing studies at Columbia. And after they did their academic thing, they started a small company. And that small company, oddly enough, was kind of like a bookstore, but instead it was a bookstore for the federal government. They sold books and research documents to the federal government. And one day in the late 80s, if any of you are familiar with Manhattan, they had an office in Columbus Circle. It was not a bookstore in the sense that you could walk in and buy books. They dealt with businesses, so it was, you know, faxes and the like. A man walked in. There was a knock on the door, and a man walked in and showed my father a business card, but showed it to him very quickly. And it, father sort of saw a glance that it said Soviet something about the UN. And the man said, "I'd like to buy some books." okay, well, what did you have in mind? And gave him a very specific list that had titles on arms, you know, nuclear proliferation and disarmament, and sort of these heady academic titles that probably two or three people read a year. And but nothing illegal. And so my father said, this is very interesting, and I'd be happy to help you. Where should I ship them to? And the man said, no. I'll come back in a few weeks and pick them up. So, and then he left, and that was it. And my father thought, oh, this is great. I just got this great account for the United Nations, and I'm sure this is something I can build upon. And quickly put it out of his head and went back to work, and was surprised to hear another knock on the door. And this time it was two other men who were also wearing trench coats and walked in and said, we're with the FBI, and the man who just came in here was Soviet intelligence. What did he want? Father said, well, he just wanted to buy some books. Is there something wrong with that? And the man said, no, we'd like to see the list. So he showed them the list, and he said, my father said, well, what should I do? And one of the FBI agents said, well, get him his books. And he said, well, okay, then what? Well, if he comes back, we'll be in touch. And they left. And so started a 20-year relationship between the Soviets, my parents, then the Russians, and then myself. So that's how I sort of fell into this. It was a family business, and it became almost, frankly, a running joke as I was growing up. You know, we saw the Russians coming in, and they'd give the list, and then my parents would give it to the FBI, and I became desensitized to it. It became sort of just part of the fabric of life. I didn't think of it as being a risk. I didn't saw the Russians as sort of being these humorous kind of, you know, kind of comic-y, sort of tripping on themselves. And I went on with my studies. I went to New York University and at some point left New York and went to Boston with my now wife. And then the way I got involved in this is September 11th happened. I was working in sort of this traditional technology role in academia, and I sort of had this moment that I felt what I was doing just didn't have much of an impact. It was sort of hard after September 11th to go and sit with I was working at Harvard, sit and talk about like planning social events for movie time and things like that. And I really wanted to do something different. And I found this great program with the Navy where I could be an intelligence officer. And I put my best foot forward and applied and was promptly rejected. So I had this great, great salt of the earth recruiter named Lino Covarrubias from Quincy, Massachusetts, who encouraged me. Said, this is something you really want to do. You know, don't be discouraged. It might take you a couple of times, but you should really do it. The only thing you have to do is you have to make sure that your second application shows growth, that you have something different in the second package that you put forward. And I said, well, okay, I guess I could do graduate school, but I don't really like school. So when I came back to New York, I had this grand idea that I could ask the FBI for a letter of recommendation. So, and this is all true, by the way. This is so I approached the FBI. I was coming back to help with a family business, and I was going to take over the Russian account. And I approached the FBI and said, hey, guys, look, I'm going to be doing this. Do you think you could, I was wondering if you could maybe help me with something in exchange. Do you think that if I help you, that could count as sort of referenceable work and you might write me a letter of recommendation to the Navy? And they looked at me and they were like, you know, they always had this sort of withholding fatherly relationship with me. And they said, well, we can't guarantee anything, but we can look into it. And I'm guessing, although I wasn't there, when they got back into the car, they're like, holy crap. Yeah, we can totally do this. Here's someone who wants a letter. He doesn't need to get out of jail. He doesn't have problems with his taxes. He's not a mobster. He's just asking for a letter of recommendation. So they're probably like, you know, cheering that this is all I asked for, which frankly, in hindsight, I probably should have asked for more. But so innocently, I got into this whole racket because I thought that my adventure would start when I joined the Navy. And fast forward, when I finally got into the Navy and I joined my first command, I was very excited to learn that I was going to be planning the Christmas party. That was my first. So, you know, I guess truth can be sometimes stranger than fiction. So that was my foray into how I actually got started in this whole crazy endeavor. And for me, it was about trying to build up some credibility to get into the Navy. And that motivation soon became eclipsed by the fact that it was a thrill. And going against Oleg Kulikov, who was my handler, He was a captain in the Russian Navy. He was a very trained and very skilled interrogator and debriefer. It became a thrill to go up against this guy and try to maneuver mentally with him, and I kind of got hooked. So the motivation switched from wanting to join the Navy to doing this whole thing and sort of beating Oleg. And what I realized early on was I had a couple of moments where, again, through my parents, I had access to the Russians, and the Russians had access to us. But there was no real relationship. For years, they had been coming in and simply giving a list of books, collecting their old books, paying and leaving. There was no relationship. My parents were not interested. My parents were children of the 60s. They, my mother had been born at the close of the Second World War. My grandfather had spent, he was in the French Army, had spent time in a prisoner of war camp. My father, of course, had been born at the height of partition between India and Pakistan. So they'd been born in the real strife. And they felt that as new citizens, it was their duty to help the FBI, but not too much. There was a fine line, and for them, they weren't interested in progressing the relationship beyond that simple status quo of getting the books, showing the list to the FBI, giving the Russians what they want, and that was it. They weren't interested in going out to dinner with the FBI. They weren't interested in getting the Russians classified information. That was it. It was a very simple for them thing to do, and they never asked for anything in return. So I tried to push the relationship and try to grow it. And I realized very early on that just because I had access to Oleg was not a guarantee that I was going to make something out of that relationship. And essentially, I had to look for ways to convince the Russians that my motivation was not the Navy, but was in fact to be a spy. And I found this great acronym known as MICE, which stands for money, ideology, coercion, and ego. And those are generally understood in the spy world as being the four pillars of motivation for spies. So I said, well, look, I can't be an ideologue. I'm not like an Islamist extremist. And although they the Russians did ask me a couple of questions about that, and so that wasn't going to work. And they weren't coercing me. They weren't threatening me. So that wasn't going to work. So I created this caricature that was based on this young kid who was into material things, who thought that he could outsmart the FBI. And my goodness, it worked. The Russians, that was exactly what they were looking for. And I built this character, again, having no training, having no schooling in this, I built this character by watching movies. And I would watch movies before I met with Oleg, take the dialogue, and use it with the Russians. And it worked. They loved it. It seemed completely believable to them that this kid would say, I mean, I would lift, Michael Mann was one of my favorite director, and I watched these movies like Miami Vice, and just take full on sentences and use it. And I can't believe that I got to say some of these things to the Russians. I mean, just one small example. At one point, Oleg asked me to sign a receipt for some money he was giving me. And I said, are you kidding me? Why would I sign a receipt? Sure, give a copy to the Department of Justice. That makes total sense. And he's looking at me, well, can't you sign the receipt for this money? I said, no. So there was a great scene in Miami Vice where they're in Haiti, and I don't want to ruin it, but the short of it is that the bad guys call the cops out as how do we know you're not the police? And their response is, well, how do we know you're not the police? So I said to Oleg, he said, well, why don't you want to sign? I go, are you kidding me? How do I know you're not the FBI? Show me your ID. And sure enough, he took his ID out and started showing me all his IDs, United Nations ID, and he was very upset, but it worked. So by using movies and by creating this character based on this movie, for whatever reason, that must have been the profile that Russian intelligence imagines an American spy should be. It worked. And that went on almost 4 years. In this weird, weird thing that I understood conceptually that Oleg was, sort of the point person for Russian military intelligence. But even working with the FBI, my world consisted of two FBI agents, my wife, and then this Russian spy handler. I had no sense of these two massive organizations. Only a few times I have a sense of these true massive organizations that I was sort of in between. And that sort of made it easy for me to get up and not be scared and do this. And it wasn't really until the end that I had this sense of of sort of the larger purpose, or that, for, and I'll be honest, for me, it was just about trying to beat Oleg. I didn't have any sense of the Russians or the FBI. To me, it was just these, they wouldn't let me in behind the curtain. So whatever they were discussing, I wasn't privy to. I just would meet with these people. So in the end, not to give away too much of the book, but obviously I'm here and he's not. We were able to sort of roll them up, and this was right around the time of Anna Chapman, right before Anna Chapman was arrested. We were both in New York. And this is an operation that was never disclosed. And I ended up being in this very weird position in that, because I was a civilian and not in the military, and at one point the FBI had asked me to sign a non-disclosure agreement, and I sort of started picking at the timeline for it. They came back and said, don't worry, you don't have to sign a non-disclosure agreement. So I'm in this crazy position where I can tell this absolutely classified story because I'm not beholden to the, to any of their requirements. And it was really a crazy adventure, and it probably was the right time that it ended. I'm sure some of you have seen the interview on 60 Minutes with Jack Barsky, who was the long-term KGB agent who ended up staying in the United States after he was sent here by the Russians. And I've had a couple conversations with him, and what we both sort of agreed upon is that once you start doing this for a while, your life, you know, I was living three lives. I was a new husband. I was starting, was running my career, trying to build a career. And oh, by the way, I was a double agent. And the last one started to become bigger and bigger and kind of bleed into the other two. And towards the end, because I didn't have this sense of, again, I didn't perceive any of the Russians except for Oleg, you start to want to almost get caught. You almost want to see what's going to happen. This can't, you know, you're almost, this really can't be real. I mean, it's, I know he's a Russian, but is he really a Russian spy handler? I mean, it doesn't seem like it. He's kind of this goofy guy. So towards the end, the FBI one day pulled me aside and said, look, from now on, you have a code name. And your code name will be Green Kryptonite. My reaction. I didn't choose this. My reaction, because I always bust the FBI's chops. I said to them, you know what, My Little Pony was taken. Like, you really couldn't think of anything better. And they said, no. We're, you know, one of the FBI agents was a big comic book fan, and so I found out I had a code name, which I thought, you know, I would never admit to them. I thought that's pretty cool. But having that part of not knowing what. Like, this feeling that, is this really real, kind of led me to make some questionable decisions. And one of them, which I will show you, was the fact that I thought it would be a very smart move to get my code name tattooed on my forearm, which I did in Morse code. So, yeah, because apparently the Russians can't read Morse code. So I had to wear a lot of long-sleeve shirts when I met with Oleg, and I didn't tell the FBI because they would have freaked out. And, you know, again, I was able to hide it from Oleg for a while. But you get to this point when you're doing these things, and I go back to that part of when I started this talk about being crazy, and that's the sort of check that you end up starting off somewhat sane and kind of going a little further to the right, perhaps. So it probably was a good time that it ended. But what I can say is that the book itself is absolutely about espionage, but there's something else that it's about, and that is, you know, as I said, both my parents were immigrants, and I for most of my life, I tried to figure out where I fit in American society. I'm first-generation American, last name Jamali, and I really wanted to be very American, and that's what sort of drove me to want to join the military and to sort of get into this whole thing, and it's an odd twist that I always find this sort of ironic that the same motivation that drove me to help the FBI was the same motivation that the Russians thought that I would be more likely to be co-opted. They assumed that because my father was Pakistani and that I was Pakistani, that I was more likely to be disloyal to our country, when the reality is that I view that as a trait that actually probably makes me more appreciative of being here than not having that. So the book is also about motivation. I don't want to say it's about race, because that's not right, but it's also about what makes an American or a person a loyal American. And I think that the Russians, looking at this, had a clearly different view about, you know, their profile says immigrants are more likely to not be loyal to their country, because frankly, look how the Russians probably treat people, immigrants in their country, not very well. And that's what they assume here. So I also hope that, you know, it's not a subtle thing, but I do hope that that's a takeaway. And, you know, especially with all the, you know, horrible things with race going on. Loyalty, what I found is loyalty and how you qualify and quantify it is a very interesting and sort of difficult thing to wrap your arms around. But it is something that nonetheless the Russians really do have a profile. And I guess part of it is race. The other part of it is apparently watching movies. I mean, I guess they love the same dialogue. So, yeah, it was. It's a great read. You know, I can also say that I'm in this lucky position that really nothing was changed. We obviously changed the names of some of the agents, but beyond that, the FBI will neither confirm nor deny that this happened. And the Navy just says, "Great, it's not our business. So it's the FBI. So you can write whatever you want." So really, everything that's in there is sort of how I remember it, and. We've been lucky enough to sell it in 12 countries, and it's going to be a movie. So very excited about that. And yeah, that's really it. I'm happy to answer questions and talk a little further, but that's my little spiel. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sahan. I'm an immigrant as well. I was born in Sri Lanka, and I'm blessed to be in this country, you know, enjoying all the freedoms, and hearing your story makes me even more American. I just want to say, you know, my question is regarding Edward Snowden. What
sure.
do you think his situation? Do you think it was a FSB operation? Because I've heard that side of the story. Some say that he just moved there just to seek asylum. So what is your take on Edward Snowden? And the second question is, who's going to be playing you in the movie?
Well, the first one. So, you know, one of the things besides watching movies, I spent a lot of time reading about traditional spies, all the way from the Second World War to the height of the Cold War. And I focused. Snowden wasn't around at that time, but this was from 2005 to 2009. So, I looked at Jonathan Pollard, Ames, Walker, Hansen. Those were the big ones to look at. And what I found, and this is sort of what I based my caricature on, was that these tended to be people who were unquestionably incredibly bright and very intelligent. But also, in most cases, they were sort of stymied in their career professionally. They had been passed over, they were not progressing, and they had a lot of resentment towards their superiors. Now, Snowden, for me, putting aside the moral question of what he did, whether it was right or wrong, I see a lot of commonalities in that profile. That there is, again, just looking at those others, that's the profile of a spy, and that's the profile that I built, and that's what the Russians were expecting, is someone who is very smart and is sort of bitter at their place of work. And I'm sure we can all relate to that. But there's a very big difference between, you know, being angry at your boss and actually doing something very sort of passive-aggressive. So I look at Snowden as really someone who fits that traditional profile, not unlike Pollard or Hansen or Ames or Walker or even Manning, that they tend to be motivated in large part by the fact. And look, Snowden, he never finished high school. He has a GED. He dropped out of the army. And I can relate, you know, being a government employee, that I can see that he probably was pretty bitter watching people who were a fraction of his intelligence be promoted above him, who were, he probably viewed as mouth breathers, and just because they had degrees, and he's probably rightfully much, much, much smarter. But that bitterness, I think, is probably a major motivation for what he did. And again, not putting any moral equivalency as to what he, you know, whether he should have done that or not. But so I don't know if it was an FSB operation, but I do think from a profile standpoint, he fits that pattern of previous spies in that regard. The second question, in terms of who's going to play me, it's the director is Mark Webb, who did the Spider-Man movies, and the screenwriter is Mark Heyman, who did Black Swan and The Wrestler. So I'm very excited to see what they can do. I have no input on anything with the movie. I'm just excited to see what comes out. So that's it. Thank you. What's that? Sure, why not?
So I'm old enough to be your mother. my question is... I worked for the State Department a couple of summers,
sure.
Right in the middle of the Cold War,
mm-hmm.
And I remember our briefing I mean, you had to have, you know, an ultra secret security clearance, a Q clearance, and I had them. And we were all graduate students, and the CIA came in and told us that the whole point, what the Russians would try to do, because we had access, was to compromise us, to offer us something, and then get us to do something that would lead to blackmail, essentially.
Sure.
It was really very terrifying. So did they try to get some information from you? I mean, you had this relationship for years and years. They must have been under some pressure to show, you know, that they were getting valuable information from you.
Sure. You know, my experience is that, again, even though I come from a technology background, mm-hmm. I look at the crown jewels of any intelligence agency are not technological capabilities. Rather,
right.
It's people.
Right.
It's assets. It's spies.
Right.
And what they're looking for is a long-term relationship. So they're looking for someone who they can run 5, 10, 15, 20 plus years.
Right.
So for them, the coercion of mice, the C, it's not going to work because it's just like torture. If take the moral equivalent, you know, the moral question out of it, it's the return. You're not going to get someone to do things for you out of fear. I mean, or you're going to get them to do just the bare minimum. So they were very good about, I mean, they could, with my parents, they would, you know, my parents wouldn't see them for 6 months, and then suddenly they would see one of their Russian contacts in the supermarket where they shopped, wheeling a, you know, a supermarket. He wouldn't say anything. He would just walk right by them. And it was a sort of subtle way of saying, we know where you live. We know where you shop. But they didn't say that. It was, so that was the extent of it. But again, coercion and fear is never really a good way to run a source because they're already under a tremendous amount of pressure. If you
do
that,
think you would be in a position to give them information?
Oh, yes, absolutely. They knew I was going to be an intelligence. They knew that I was applying to be an intelligence officer. And to be fair, this is something people get very, very tripped up on. So when I first got into the Navy and I was looking at sort of, the high side systems, the classified stuff, you know, what is classified, people make the mistake of assuming that it's like this amazing stuff. And that's not always the case. There's a tremendous amount of useful information that's known as open source or unclassified.
Right.
And for the Russians, it's also important to understand that your enemies might know what information you want, but you only tell your friends the information you don't have. So by the Russians coming and saying, we're looking for books on, you know, manufacturing or on radar, whatever crazy, you know, engineering things they were looking for, what they were doing was admitting that these were subjects that they had a deficiency, i.e. what's known in the intelligence world as an intelligence gap. So the intelligence community, that's a huge boom. You can say, okay, boon rather, this is stuff that the Russians are actively interested in and they do not have information on it. And that's all open source. So, that was very valuable to them, but they also were investing with me. Unlike my parents, they were investing in me as a future asset who would continue to deliver more and more interesting and high-level stuff.
Thank you.
Sure.
Marianne Kane here. Your story is really intriguing.
And thank you.
You're very casual about the remarkableness of it. I mean, you know, to be able to be a double agent and to pull that off. And I just wondered if you, when you were in the midst of performing, if you felt like there were times when you were in danger, or your family might have been in danger, perhaps your wife or someone close to you, because that is a way of controlling,
sure.
you know, people. And then also, looking forward, I wondered if now that the story is going to be much more public and much more available to higher-ups within Russia, if there is now perhaps a sense that, you know, there could be some threat to your family.
Well, I can answer it. So the first one, you know, I was just married. I had no children. So obviously when you have kids, it changes everything. So I was young. I was in my late 20s. I was somewhat, unbeatable. I viewed myself as indestructible. So that's just youth. I think we can... That's probably not specific just to me. But no, I wasn't, again, part of it was just the comedy. I think that my sense of my maturity probably peaked at 16, so I would always laugh at this stuff. And so I sort of, that was my way of dealing with the stress, is to look at this and say, this is all a big joke. insofar as the so that there was no time that I was ever afraid the Russians were going to do anything to me. I mean, there was one time when they asked me to go to Mexico with them, and the FBI, and I was thinking, great, I'm going to go to Mexico. This is going to be awesome. I don't have to pay for it. And the FBI said, you know, you really can't do that. That's not a good idea. And it's probably good that I didn't. but insofar as now, look, the Russians, I hold no ill will to them. They were, it's a professional military, it's a professional intelligence agency. They follow the same rules we do. It's not, as I always say to them, it's not personal, it's just business. And look, at the end, when Oleg sort of knew the gig was up, you know, after all these things of saying these great, like, we're going to give you a big party, you're going to have a number to count, you're going to have retirement and all this, when he saw that I was in, you know, that I'd been caught, he essentially turned his back and walked away without looking back. So I don't think that they're going to do anything. It's not, that's just, there's nothing for them to benefit by doing so. And it's sort of not the rules. I mean, look, this is, we won this round, they've won the next round. It just goes back and forth. It goes on and on. I'm not terribly worried about it.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
I saw in the acknowledgments that the decision was made not to use last names. Was that your decision? Was it the decision of the people who you were?
There was no one. So the only last names we didn't use were for the active duty FBI
yes.
agents.
Well, I thought also some of the Navy people.
No, we used all their names. Oh. They were okay with it. The Navy signed off on they signed off on everything. The only names that we changed were the FBI agents. And, you know, that was, again, no one asked me to do that. I could have very well put them in there. I just didn't think that was fair to them. They're still doing their job. There's nothing to be gained. Thank you. Yes.
Now that you've blown your own cover.
Yes.
What's next for you?
Hopefully I'm never going back to the corporate world. I don't mind, you know, this has been an interesting, you were asking me, why am I so casual about it? Well, the weird thing about it is I spent so many years being casual about it because no one knew. It was just, it was like something I did, and then I put it, when it was finished, I kind of put it in the trunk and put it in the attic and forgot about it. So right now I'm just having fun telling the story. It's been a weird total 180 from going to literally three people in the world who knew that I was doing this to now, you know, we have a book that I have a book that's out and, you know, potentially a movie. So, I'm still in the Navy. I still am very interested in sort of the insider threat and how to focus. I feel very strongly that there's a miss as a result of September 11th. The focus was too much on race and ethnicity as sort of an indicator of a threat or loyalty of someone. And I really want to focus on how there are more creative and more fair ways to actually catch a bad guy, not to just say, well, that guy's got brown skin and a last name like Jamali. Let's, you know, give him extra security when he gets on a plane. That's not the way to do it. So I'm sort of focused on technology that is in that space, and, you know, we'll see what else happens.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. It's not clear to me exactly what kind of information you had that the Russians wanted.
They're sort of like remoras. So the fish that sort of hang on to sharks that kind of feed off whatever the shark eats, they'll take whatever you have access to. And again, they weren't interested. They weren't there saying we have to collect on the F-35 or this ICBM. They have a sort of limited window based on what their asset can collect. So, I mean, to answer your question specifically, I had access to government databases because we were running a federal contracting firm, and there was a lot of sort of technology that we were using to pull information and some pretty heady stuff. A lot of it was research papers and the like. But again, their real focus for me was to develop me as a source. And once I got into, they wanted to see that I was the real deal, that I could deliver, and if I could deliver now, then when I was, you know, sitting at the Office of Naval Intelligence, I was going to have access to real stuff and to pass, you know, much more interesting documents to them, I'm sure. Thanks. Yes.
My perception of the Russian intelligence over the years is a reasonably capable organization.
Mm-hmm.
Also, just generally, different countries running intelligence organizations. You'd think that one of the things they would do when a new recruit is involved is to put them through some kind of screening beyond what you've said about checking your personality and motivation.
Sure.
Characteristics. So did they do anything that was at all rigorous in trying to determine?
Yeah. I mean, listen, absolutely. Every time I met with them, I don't want to make it sound, I mean, I laughed at it, but it was very intense. They weren't going to polygraph me, right? They couldn't, we were meeting at Pizzeria Uno's. They're not going to bring out like a polygraph machine in the middle of that or Hooters. I mean, it was just not going to work. And they wanted, there's a fine line between validating and scaring someone off. And as you saw from just the simple, innocuous receipt they wanted me to sign, I flipped out about that. They understood they had to be very kind of tread very carefully. But that's not to say that when I met with him, he was very good. I mean, one of the greatest moves that he had was he would come over and shake my hand and then say, "So where were you last weekend?" And you can't lie. It's almost impossible. You can't look down. I mean, he was very, very skilled interrogator. And they had a lot of tactics and methods that they used that were, you know, they were interrogation methods. But they weren't, you know, they weren't going to hit me with a phone book or something like that to try to, "You working for the FBI?" No, it wasn't anything like that. And I assume that they did a lot of open source checking and they knew, you know, specifics about like where I lived and things like that. But those are, you know, those are readily available. Thanks.
I've enjoyed the presentation very much.
Thank you very much.
I find it a really intriguing story, and certainly seems very real.
not crazy, right?
Yeah, not crazy. The one thing that I'm still very unclear about
sure.
is what is their sense of your motivation, which...
The Russian sense?
Yeah, the Russian sense of your motivation, which, as you sort of alluded to the fact that you fit the profile, that you
yeah.
were somewhat disgruntled in some way with...
I made it very clear that I wanted one thing, and that was money. And they understood that as being sort of this capitalist...
Okay, well, that was really the other part of the question,
yeah.
was how did you go about what? How much money, where did they give it to you, and
so,
what happened to the money?
So... A lot, yeah. So I can tell you the great thing about this is the Russians funded this entire operation against them out of their pocket. So it was sort of a double kind of, you know, stick it to them. The one of the most difficult and complex questions that I had to answer was, what do you charge for treason? And you had to come up with some metric, some way of saying, I'm going to do this for this much money. And that this much can't be just something that you pull out of the air. Because...
This is why I asked the question.
Yes. So it became a very delicate... Part of it was guesswork, but part of it was this... It's almost like bidding on a federal contract. You sort of have this sense... I mean, this really was like sales. You have this sense of what the market will bear. How much... I mean, look, at the end of the day, the Russians, they're a government agency. They are given a budget. They probably cannot exceed that budget. He's probably given discretionary funding, and he clearly, when he would meet with me, he would sometimes have three envelopes, and he would try to give me the smaller one. So, but beyond that, he probably couldn't, like, say it's $15,000, and I said 20. 20 might have been his threshold to go back, that he had to go back and get approval to give me that additional money. So part of this was saying, well, we don't want to go too low, because if it's too low, then if you're saying money is your motivation, you're willing to do something for nothing. It doesn't quite work.
Right.
But if you go for too high, they just don't have the money. And they say, it's not worth it. But what I can tell you is that based on Oleg and who he was and sort of the time that they spent with me, this was time and money that they were spending on me and not someone else who was a real asset. It took a lot of effort for them to come and meet with me and do all these things. But the short of it is I had to come up with ideas of what to charge. And I would give the money back to the FBI. I wasn't allowed to keep it. And the FBI would then, you know, essentially give it back to me, which was very uncomfortable. And I had to declare it on my taxes, which was even more... It's a whole other story. I listed as consulting, by the way, which was always... So I paid 32%
So you were able to provide some evidence that you were actually using this money. I would think that the Russians would want to see some evidence that this was
your life. So part of playing the character was looking like a young a-hole, frankly. And I made sure that I had a Corvette at the time. I made sure the Russians saw the car. I wasn't wearing a $10,000 suit, but I would. So you tried to make what I was asking for money based on what he perceived my lifestyle was.
Right.
And that was the connection. But it was very, you have to be very carefully thought out. And you're absolutely right. They looked at everything. And, they kind of knew where I lived. They probably had a sense of what it cost and things like that. So all these things just had to sync up. And if they didn't sync up, they would absolutely, right. Call you on it. And again, it just worked.
You must have to buy cars, from time to time.
I had no kids, so I could be a little more frivolous in my spending. But yeah, I actually went through quite a few cars with the Russians. And yeah, there's a lot of stuff. I happen to like cars, and there's quite a bit of stuff about cars in there. And at one point, Oleg came out and said, is that a Mustang? And I didn't have a Mustang. I had a Corvette. And we almost got into a fight over that. So that was, I felt that that was like a real, I know he didn't mean it, but it was like a real disparaging remark. but they were very, he watched everything. They took note of everything. And look, I would meet with him. He would write up, I'm sure after he met, incredibly detailed reports, and they would analyze them and overanalyze them and figure out what to do next. And for our part, we would do the same thing. We'd sit there with the FBI and try to game out exactly how we want the conversation to go. And you're both trying to control it. And no one ever gets to control it completely. It's just, it's impossible. So, but yeah, that's sort of how we did it. Thank you. Anyone else? I do know. It's nice to know that if you screw up, regardless of what country you work for, you get thrown under the bus. So he's back in Russia, and I do feel bad for him because his career kind of imploded after this. So he's probably thinking, at this point, it ended in 2009, so it's a number of years ago. So he's probably just getting his life back on track, and the poor guy, now there's a book coming out about him. And I do feel a little bad for him, but he's back in Russia. He's never going to leave Russia again, I'm sure. As far as I know, he's not working in the Russian Russian intelligence service anymore. Yes?
So I can't even speak through this thing. What did your wife think of all this, or did you even tell her?
I don't want to ruin it, but there is a very funny scene about how my wife found out about how I did this. And I'll just leave it with, it included a female FBI agent and a tampon, and that's how my wife found out. So you'll have to read the book. And she was, it just felt this whole thing. You'd wake up, you're like, this isn't real. And she would just like, she would just, I was complaining to her about the FBI and the Russians as much as I would of any, difficult customer or boss. So none of us had the sense of what was going on until almost the very end when, at this point, she was 6 months pregnant, and they actually flew us to Quantico to talk. But before that, they invited us to dinner. The FBI did. And if any of you are familiar with Manhattan and 26 Federal Plaza, which is the FBI built, the big federal building in New York, they invited us to 26 Federal Plaza, and we got a cab at 5 o'clock. It was like a Wednesday, and we were 45 minutes late because the traffic was so bad. And Terry, who was one of my handlers, that's not his real name, met me. And took us, whisked us through the building. And they took us to this elevator, and it was like this really cool, cylinder-shaped elevator with a seal of the FBI on the floor. And I said, wow, this is a really cool elevator. Is this what you take to go to work? And he's like, Naveed, in the 12 years I've been here, I've never been in this elevator. And I said, well, this is odd. And so we get up to this floor, and the doors open, and it's like filled exactly what you would think of something from 24, all these cubes with computers and TVs. And there's no one there. It's completely empty. And they whisk us into this conference room. And there's this really cool looking guy who starts shaking my hand and telling my wife, you should be very proud of your husband and did a great thing. And they take all these pictures with us. And he says, I'm sorry you were late and I won't be joining you for dinner, but I hope you guys have a good time. And as we're walking, they said, so what did you think about meeting the assistant director of the FBI? I had no idea who it was. So that was really when we had a sense of some of the, and they gave me this great letter that we include in the book, it's actually gonna be online. But that was really the only time that and that was almost a few months after this whole thing had ended. That was really only the only time I had a sense of some of the bigger thing to this than just what I was doing. So they did a pretty good job of the FBI did a pretty good job of kind of separating me from all that whole world. Yes.
Didn't they ever ask you what you believed in?
The Russians?
Yeah, I mean...
Only once.
The English spies did it because they believed in, you know, communism.
Ideology didn't work for me. The Russians were perfectly happy with thinking that I was doing this for money. They understood Americans as... That's what they sort of envision Americans are. And look, the Russians aren't that different, right? They're pretty... It's a pretty corrupt country right now. I mean, they... Totally believable that I was doing this for money. They were comfortable with that. If you know, again, it's not this moral assignment. They looked at those four silos and they said, okay. They asked me once about God, and they made some question, like some sort of comment about, like, that sort of alluded to Islam. And I'm not Muslim, but I couldn't take that on because that's not. I wouldn't even know how to have a conversation about that. So he asked Oleg asked me once something along the lines of, you know. In you know, inshallah, he didn't actually say that, but he said like the English version of you know, God willing, and I said, and it was just really weird. I was like, what the hell does that mean? And that was the last time he ever said anything like that. So he was very comfortable that it was about money, and that worked. Yes.
Do you get a sense right now, sort of after Ukraine annexation of Crimea and sort of Russia's more oppositional turn against the West? Sort of like on the ground level for intelligence, do you feel like Russia has really changed very much, like since you were working it and right now?
Look, I mean, my parents started, this whole thing started in the late 80s. And from the Soviets to the, you know, collapse of the Berlin Wall to the emergence of Gorbachev's Russia to Putin, you know what? There was no change. They did the exact same thing. It was the same exact people. I think it's just same salad, different dressing. I don't think they've ever changed. They, you know, they're again. It's not a moral thing. They're here to collect intelligence. They're not going to change. There's no reason for them not to. It's hugely successful. Why would they stop? So, thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as you've heard tonight, this How to Catch a Russian Spy is an absolutely extraordinary story. And I think given the upcoming movie and the publicity it's been getting across the nation, I think this certainly won't be the last time you hear of it. So I urge you to read it. As I say, it's a story you won't hear anywhere else. And it's absolutely compelling. So thank you all very much for coming out. And thank you, Naveed, for telling us so much.